The universe began nearly 14 billion years ago, an event that we call the Big Bang. The evidence that this is true is simply overwhelming, with perhaps the most compelling example being the discovery of the remnants of that primordial fireball. This data is a staggering treasure trove of information about the universe. So let's look into it. The cosmic microwave background radiation, or CMB, is the earliest thing we can see in the history of the cosmos. It was discovered in 1964, and it represents a time when the universe cooled enough to be transparent, a mere 380,000 years after the universe began. Because of the expansion of the universe from then until the present day, the temperature of the afterglow of the Big Bang is now 2.7 Kelvin, or minus 450 degrees below zero Fahrenheit. That temperature is the same in every direction. Indeed, the CMB is a sphere around us. However, to represent that sphere here on the screen, we need to make it two-dimensional. That's done in the same way this map of the Earth is done. So what you see here is a representation of the CMB as seen from Earth. Red is 5.4 Kelvin and blue is 0 Kelvin. Of course, you don't see either red or blue. All you see is green, which represents 2.73 Kelvin. The reason it's green everywhere is the CMB is the same in every direction to within about a tenth of a percent. The measurement was made much more precisely in 1998, when a satellite called the Cosmic Background Explorer, or COBE, looked for tiny variations in the CMB. When researchers looked at the data, they saw that half of the sky was a little hotter than the other, with one side being 2.724 and the other side being 2.732 Kelvin. What's that all about? While the simple existence of the CMB told the biggest story, which is that the Big Bang happened, this little non-uniformity is because the Earth is moving with respect to the CMB. It's the same basic idea as the Doppler shift that astronomers use to tell us that galaxies are effectively moving away from us, except this tiny shift tells us that compared to the average velocity of the universe, the Milky Way is moving about 370 kilometers per second in the direction of the constellation Leo. Once we understand that the Milky Way is moving compared to the average of the rest of the universe, we can subtract off that effect and look for even smaller variations. Now the differences in temperature between red and blue that you see here are only 200 microkelvin, and we see this red stripe across the equator. That red stripe is caused by microwaves emitted by gas in the Milky Way, and we have to subtract that off too. When the COBE astronomers erased the contribution from the Milky Way, they were left with this red and blue splotchy picture, which is a precise measurement of the tiny non-uniformities in the CMB. The temperature difference between the red and blue spots in this picture is only about 20 microkelvin. This was a huge accomplishment, but we need to give some context. Here is a picture of the Earth and what that same picture would be like if it were photographed by the COBE satellite and that photograph were processed through the COBE algorithms. You see, it's pretty blurry. Now, this shouldn't be thought of as a criticism. The COBE result is already 20 years old, and the technology used in the satellite was older still. However, there have been two other satellites launched in the intervening time, one called WMAP in 2001, and one called Planck, launched in 2009. As you can see here, each instrument was able to image the CMB with improved precision, and the Planck satellite gives the best image of the CMB. This is simply a treasure trove of information. There's a lot of science in them there spots. Those spots reflect sound waves that were present in the universe when it was 380,000 years old. Sound is just density variation in the material, in this case the plasma of the early Big Bang. The reddish-orange spots are locations where the plasma was denser, and the bluish spots are where it was less dense. Now, it turns out to not be super hard to calculate the most common wavelengths that could develop in the Big Bang's hot plasma before the CMB became visible. Furthermore, we know how far away the sphere that holds the CMB is in the present day. Those two distances set up a triangle, and astronomers can calculate what should be the most common angle between adjacent hotspots. It turns out to be about 1 degree. But hold on. That's if space is flat. If space is curved in some way, say like a sphere or a saddle, then the lines connecting the CMB and our eyes will be distorted. That will make the apparent angle different from what happens in flat space, and it will change the distance we see between adjacent spots. Bigger if space is spherical, and smaller if space is saddle-shaped. That means measuring the angular distance between adjacent spots is a good way to determine the flatness of space. So, if we look at the Planck data, we can determine the most common angle between bright spots. And what do we see? A drum roll, please. It's about 1 degree. We can see that here. The symbols and data and the line is a fit, and the peak is at about 1 degree. So that means that space is flat, or nearly so. However, this is an experimental measurement, which means that the 1 degree number isn't infinitely precise. It has an uncertainty associated with it. If you take that uncertainty, you can say that while flat space is most likely, the uncertainty allows at most a curvature of space of about 0.2%. This maximum curvature of 0.2% means that the universe is bigger than we can see, with the total universe having a radius of at least 500 times bigger than the visible universe. And that means that the volume of the entire universe is at least 125 million times bigger than the universe we can see. It could be even bigger. And all that information can be determined just by looking at these tiny non-uniformities in the CMB. That still just blows my mind. But the CMB has more to tell us. It turns out that the spacing between adjacent bright and dark spots change depending on the mix of ordinary matter, and dark energy in the universe. You can see here how the likelihood of finding different angles depends on how much dark matter existed in the early universe. Since varying those parameters changes the prediction, we can compare the prediction and measurement and get a precise determination of the amount of both the ordinary and dark matter in the universe. Ordinary matter is 4.9% and dark matter is 25.9%. Vary those fractions just a tiny bit and data and prediction don't agree. Just amazing. The CMB has been a pretty incredible tool to help us understand the universe. In this video, I've told you that it tells us how fast the Milky Way is moving compared to the average of the rest of the universe. I've explained how it tells of the most probable shape and minimum size of the cosmos, and it also strongly validates the existence of dark matter. And those aren't the only things. The whole thing is just extraordinary. It might surprise you that so much information can be gleaned from a faint radio signal from space, but that's science for you. In our next video, I'm going to tell you about a couple of unsolved mysteries and tantalizing discoveries that may still lurk in the CMB, the afterglow of the Big Bang. So that was pretty amazing. We truly do live in a golden time, cosmologically speaking. If you enjoyed the video, please like, subscribe, and share. And be sure to come back for the third and final episode about the CMB, where we'll talk more about one of the most fascinating signals of all of physics. And that's saying something because, well, you know, physics is everything.